first verse, "Hark, my soul, it is the Lord. My spirit is speaking to my soul." Then the Lord takes over, and the Lord begins to speak to me. And the last verse is my response to Him. Psalm 42:11, "Why are you in despair, O my soul? And why have you become disturbed within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise Him, the help of my countenance and my God." So that is my spirit speaking to my soul. We can do this any time of the day, in office or at home, when my soul is in despair, but still my spirit is in touch with the Lord and receiving from Him. And my spirit is speaking to the soul and saying, "Why are you trying to get into the shoe? Get up. Why have you become disturbed within me? Hope in God." Slides. "For I shall yet praise Him, the help of my countenance and my God." So I want to take a few conversations, a short one at the beginning, what the Lord Jesus had with the devil, and how we can use that conversation for our benefit. Then a little long conversation that the Lord Jesus Christ had with a lady from Samaria, and the last one, Paul having with Timothy. So the spirit speaking to the body. "But he answered and said, it is written." Who is speaking? The Lord Jesus is speaking in his temptations. "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." That's the medical therapy for obesity. Also for food fads, you need to speak to your body and tell the fellow, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." It certainly has spiritual application, because God's word feeds our spirit, feeds our soul, but God's word feeds our body also. "Beloved, in regard to all things, I pray that you prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers." This in itself is a full sermon. But you need to speak to your body. If you have a disturbed sleep pattern and you wake up very late in the morning, you need to speak to your body and say, "Wake up on time." When you are going to bed, you say, "Lord Jesus, give me good sleep, good memory, brain bright, good dreams. I want to wake up at 5 in the morning or 5:30 in the morning." Because when you are getting up, it's good to see sunrise. That's how your melatonin and all your body systems get into order, your insulin, growth hormone and all that. If you see morning sunrise, you're into health. If every morning you're not missing morning sunrise because of late sleeping or wrong sleeping habits, you're asking for trouble with your body. Give me a wave if you understood that. So speak to your body to do the thing that God has asked the body to do. Till as long as we live on earth, our body should serve us in the call of God. Our body should serve our soul and our spirit, isn't it? And Psalm 5 says, Lord gives His beloved good sleep. So part of it is having bad dreams come first, good dreams next. So when you wake up, you must have a remembrance of a good dream. Then you have had proper God-given physiological sleep. Did you understand that? I just gave an example of how you to speak to yourself in the night, in the spirit, to your body, your sleep systems and everything, where day really begins at 12 midnight. You know that. So better take authority over your body and your physique from 12 midnight onwards by committing yourself to prayer. So go to sleep without wrath dwelling on you, correct? Ephesians 5 says, let not sun go down on your wrath. That is medical advice. Speak to yourself and check yourself before going to sleep. Have I got wrath, bitterness, any conflict of the day trying to go into the night? Stop it in Jesus' name. Did you understand how I applied Jesus' conversation with the devil? Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Apply the word of God to all parts of your physical needs and physical systems. So when you sit to eat also, eat only what is necessary. And then regular fasting, if you have no other medical issue. All these are God-given measures for us to. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Speaks to bodily appetites to live ruled by God's word. Speak to health fears. Many people fear symptoms and get into diseases. So the first symptoms that come, just say in Jesus' name, the Lord will look after my health. It may be a headache, it may be a pain somewhere. Don't grow on your symptom, grow on the word of God. Let's say together, I will not grow on my symptoms. I will grow on the word of God. This is not to deny diseases. This is don't make every symptom a disease. This is important spiritual living. Speak divine health to your body. And as I said at the beginning, 3 John 1, 2 is a scripture that you need to memorize. Until it gets into your system, keep it up somewhere you can see. Beloved, in regard to all things, I pray that you prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers. Second temptation, Jesus speaks to the devil, took him up into the holy city and set him up on a pinnacle of the temple. And he said to him, the devil is speaking, if you are the Son of God, cast yourself down. Jesus said to him, on the other hand, it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. So we speak to our ambitions. Once we get to a certain height, the temptation comes to attempt something that is not in the will of God. Or in getting into it, you will go out of the will of God. You will damage yourself. So there's a spiritual discernment necessary. When you are at that point, God has blessed you, taken you there. At that point, you must have a sensitivity of the spirit. If I do this ambition thing that is prompting me, I will go out of the will of God, and I don't want to go out of the will of God. You have to, and this relevant conversation you need to do is, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. The good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth what is good, and the evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth what is evil, for his mouth speaks from the abundance of the heart. So we have to school our heart always about the things that pop out of our mouth. We most believe what we speak. If you say, I can never get this study done before such and such a time, you will believe it. We most believe what we speak because we most like to hear our voice. It's a fact. That's why when you are studying, you are advised to read certain difficult parts of your study little audibly. Little, you know, you even scriptures, you need to read softly to yourself or at family prayer time together. Yeah, we must listen to the voice, okay? All right. So speak the scriptures out till the scriptures become your hearing voice. Let's say together, I will read the scriptures out. Yeah, you're listening. I will read the scriptures out, particularly the Psalms, till scriptures that I read becomes my hearing voice and my speaking voice. Did you understand that? So you read the Psalm, you're reading it little audibly, and at family prayer time, agreeing with your wife, and that spoken voice of the word stays with you through the day. A temptation comes, the voice of the word speaks. It's another matter that Psalm 103 verse 22 says, angels act on the voice of the word they hear. Psalm 103 verse 22, when you are speaking the word for a spiritual need for yourself or someone else, angels hear the voice of his word and they go and do it. So it's a good habit always to speak in the word of God about a need, about a problem, about a trouble. Don't speak the trouble. You are troubling the trouble. Speak the word over the trouble. I find many people keep regurgitating the trouble, meaning they speak the trouble. That's the voice you will carry. We want to speak the word over the trouble. There was a storm, Jesus said, peace be still. So speak the word over the trouble. Don't illustrate the trouble. Keep on repeating the trouble. Recirculate the trouble. Speak the word over the trouble. I never recirculate any clip of trouble. In fact, I don't watch clips of trouble at all. Because I want to hear the voice of the Lord. I can read the trouble in internet news. I read it very carefully. So I read it discerningly. I don't want to listen to a voice that is telling me trouble. I want to read it, take it up to God in prayer, and speak the voice of the word over the temptation. which is the next one I am going to do. Then Jesus said to him, "Go, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve. Therefore, submit yourself to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you." Now, we have a prayer card, a green-colored prayer card. Hiranti and I read it daily. Please read that prayer card daily or even twice a day. Can I get a green-colored prayer card? Do you have it in your Bible? Yeah. This is the green-colored prayer card. Please take one for yourself. It has a wonderful prayer of agreement, and its most consistent scripture is, "No weapon that is formed against you shall prosper. Every tongue that riseth against you in judgment, you will condemn. For this is the heritage of the servant of the Lord, and their righteousness is from me, saith the Lord." So you can see how much of the scripture I keep speaking over the day, over every situation. So please, let's do it like that. Now we get into Jesus and the Samaritan lady. John chapter 4, verses 6 to 7. "And Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, being wearied from his journey, was sitting thus by the well." So my point here is this happenstance? Is this God destined, this conversation? It was about the sixth hour, that is about 12 noon. Usually in Israel, people go for water late in the evening. They draw the water and get ready for the next day. So this lady's lifestyle is contrary to normal. When she goes to draw water at 12 noon, it's not normal. But at that time, Jesus is at the well. "There came a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said to her, 'Give me a drink.'" That's the start of a conversation from where she is. She came to draw water. Jesus says, "Give me a drink." Now, it's a very unequal association. He is the Savior. He is the Messiah. He is the Holy One. And Jesus from the beginning knew who she was. But he relates to her with no prejudice, and she gets no indication at all that he has any other sense than having a good conversation with her. Whom you meet is prepared by God for a LCC, life-changing conversation. Will you say with me, LCC, life-changing conversation. Christ was in unfriendly territory, Jew versus Samaritan, male versus female, religious teacher versus a prostitute, isn't it? A very unequal situation, but he makes it equal by his demeanor, by his bearing, the way he speaks, and he starts the conversation on her ground level. Those are the successful conversations. You start a conversation on that person's ground level. Now, Jesus knew where he has to bring her, but he starts where she is, and she's immediately open to this conversation. She brings up an objection. "Therefore, the Samaritan woman said to him, 'How is it that you, being a Jew, ask me for a drink, since I am a Samaritan woman?'" Quite a sort of, you know. Have you met people like that? Going for marketing or... Usually doctors don't meet people like that. Especially anesthetists meet very humble people just at the moment of getting anesthetized. But lawyers may be meeting people like that. Maybe marketers meet people like that, isn't it? For some reason, there was a lot of oomph in her. But Jesus is undeterred. So she asks a very awkward, contradictory question. So Hebrews 12 says, Jesus bore the contradictions of sinners easily. Now, people normally say in English language, "I don't suffer a fool gladly." Have you heard that statement? That's a very arrogant statement, because we all were foolish enough to deny the Lord for a long time, isn't it? So don't use some proverbs, because they are in the language, because they are not in the nature of God. So never say, "I will not suffer a fool gladly." Because we were all foolish in the sight of God at the beginning, rejecting Him. And in many times, we have made mistakes. We have done follies, isn't it? So don't use what is available in the English language or any other language, which is contrary to the conversation of Christ. Can you give me a wave on it? So be very careful what you like on Facebook. I have a close relative on Facebook, and his humor is excellent. I don't know how he gets it, where he gets it, maybe from his older brother. But you know, if I like his post, I'll have to like a lot of things that are not quite the conversation of Christ. Because we are in a very social media savvy world. Take care what conversations you're getting engaged with unwittingly. Because we want to be in the conversation of Christ, which is God honoring, soul saving, spirit edifying. Here are three rules for life-changing conversations. One, God honoring. Two, spirit edifying. Three, soul saving. So before you start a conversation, ask these three questions. Before you make a response, even on social media or wherever, telephone call, conversations must be God honoring, spirit edifying, soul saving. Okay? So even in market dealings, all the time you can't say repent or perish, but you will not engage in a conversation that is soul disparaging or spirit destroying, isn't it? Or God dishonoring. Certainly not. Even because of a job requirement, we are not going to do that. Shall we say that together? Even because of a job requirement, all together, even because of a job requirement, my speech will not be God dishonoring, spirit destroying, soul despairing. No, we are not going to go there, isn't it? So any news that we receive, we are not going to violate those three fundamental principles about life-changing conversations. Yes. So then we get on to the second objection the lady raised. Therefore, the Samaritan woman, the first objection, said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask me for a drink, since I am a Samaritan woman?" She spoke out of her racial identity. She spoke out of her national identity, fiercely guarding her defenses. So we take care that we don't speak out of our racial identity, nationalist identity, prejudices we have accumulated down the line. We don't want them to speak on our behalf. Agreed? So we take care about people who have hurt us, not been nice to us, political parties we don't like. We guard our heart, lest our heart speaks God dishonoring, spirit not edifying, not soul saving. Can I have a wave on that? So these are the Christ-centric conversations, life-changing conversations we want to have. She was fiercely guarding her defenses because she was a lady who had to negotiate her worth, make arbitration for her charges. She had a very difficult life. All that life spoke at Jesus. And Jesus was a savior who could absorb all that. As you proceed through this conversation, you will find how many provocative things she said in just this simple conversation across the veil. But the Lord was not put off, isn't it? Lord was not offended. He's the Lord Almighty, the King of creation. But He was Savior at all times. Same with us. We are ambassadors for Christ, however difficult the conversation is. Shall we say together? However difficult the conversation is, thank you. We are ambassadors for Christ. It may be a junior who is questioning our witness, wisdom, without knowing anything about the subject. I come across this all the time because I am not a practicing doctor. They quibble with what I say. So what to do? People are like that. So don't get put off. Christ didn't get put off. He had three things in mind: God honoring, spirit edifying. This lady's soul must be saved at the end of this conversation. Then the next objection, Jesus, how did he overcome? He said to her, "If you knew the gift of God, who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink.'" So we are all the time thinking in any conversation, how do I get him to understand Christ, the giver. How do I get him to understand the gift of Christ? These are the two uppermost things a Christian has in any conversation. How do I get the person to know Christ the giver? How do I get the person to know the gift Christ has given? And we begin on the basis everybody has a gift Christ has given, and already people are using the gift God has given. They are already benefiting from it. So man is created in the image of the goodness of God. Everyone is created with a certain facility, ability about which that person is really happy. That's that sense of worthiness that God puts to people. God doesn't run down people. God has put worthiness to people. It's out of that worth people get into work fields and earn. So we can start on the basis of God's goodness that brings people to repentance. Romans 2:4. God's goodness that brings people to repentance. There is God's severity also. But Jesus approaches on the basis of God's goodness. Shall we say together? God's goodness that brings people to repentance. So he speaks to him at the point of her need. You would have asked him and he would have given you living water. Jesus is not put off by her offensive attitude. Gift of God is the offer. Disarmed by offering a gift rather than laws of demand or what she is required to do. Then she gets on to another field. You are not greater than our father Jacob, are you? Who gave us this well and drank of it himself and his sons and his cattle. You can see how belligerent she is, isn't it? She's all the time, you know, boxing Christ. Of course, Christ is well able to do this, isn't it? He's a savior. So we are in the image of Christ. We have our intention clear in all conversations. What are the three things? God, honoring. Spirit, edifying. Soul, saving. We are not going to be provoked out of that frame. Agreed? Shall we have a wave on this? We are not going to be provoked out of this frame. So she was quite... Then she upgrades her offense. Challenges Christ's personhood. Compares him with Jacob. So don't get put off for that. If someone is comparing you and putting you down, don't get put off, because we want to win this person's soul. Wash the feet even and go down as much as possible and win the person's soul, isn't it? Yes. When do we speak from our lofty tradition, background, wealth or education? So we learn something where she was speaking from a lofty tradition, a background, whatever she had. She didn't have much, but she had a lot of oomph. Jesus was not put off. Let's pray about this. Lord Jesus, we find in Sri Lanka a lot of banter, acidic words, vitriol, anger, spewing in every kind of news media and in conversations. Lord, we don't want to be tarnished by any of these things, Lord. We don't want to speak of a lofty tradition. We don't want to call our high background, cultured background to fight battles. We only want to have the Savior's demeanor, Savior's way, Savior's word to be God-honoring, spirit-edifying and soul-saving. Help us, Lord. So we learn to take all upgrades and all downgrades to the cross. Did you understand that? Through the day, we get downgrades. People don't know our real value. That's okay. How many times they were asking Christ theological questions to check his theological knowledge. Here is the creator. They're asking him quibbles about whether he knows what he's talking about. So don't take up degrades personally. Don't take downgrades personally. Take it to the cross. And when upgrades come, you still say, it's the grace of God. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15:10, I serve more than them all. But 'tis not I, but Christ that was in me. So when the next downgrade comes, take it to the cross. When the next upgrade comes, say, thank you, Jesus. It is your grace. Shall we give a hand clap for Christ who did it for us on the cross? Christ who did it for us on the cross. Then Jesus switches from the temporal to the eternal. Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water, will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never, never thirst again. But the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water, springing up to eternal life." So when we speak to people and speak to ourselves also, don't think of yourself from the last bad point that happened. Bitter tastes linger longer on the tongue. That's why when you eat something bitter, you have to do that to your tongue. Drink hot water, remember? It doesn't go easily. Same with bitter tastes on the brain. Bitter tastes, brain remembers more. Now I'm meaning about downgrades, you know. So, but don't think of yourself. Don't think of someone else from the bitter place, bad experience you had. Think of the water that can keep gushing out, making it much more better. We have to switch to this better mode. Expectation is better. So Christ took the contradictions of sinners, but look to the end. That's Trinity College, isn't it? Look to the end. I think that's Trinity College. Look to the end. Look to the better hope that Christ has given us. Will you give a wave on that? Now think of something that is very bitter in your life. It's very, very difficult to bear. But it may be a recurrent pain. Whatever, broken relationship. Some defrauding that happened to your life in the past. Very bitter, isn't it? Very bitter. Anytime a Tamil person sees soldiers coming and checking identity card, government doesn't understand the difficulty they go through. They think it's normal. But we remember. But we take a step according to what Jesus said, whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never go back to the thirst, the bitter, the down. We go forward. Shall we say that together? We go forward and upward. We don't go back to the need, the thirst, the pain, the isolation, the solitariness. Not easy, but we make a decision. Not easy, we make a decision that with Christ, the water I give him will become in him a well of water springing up to Christ's life, eternal life. Can we believe that on anything which is dry, dreary, drudgery, not good, we are expecting the fountain of Christ to open up in us for that problem. This is how we overcome Sri Lanka's present imbroglio, the difficult situation. Every day we hear Sri Lanka is going down. Every day. But we are saying, Lord, this nation is created for better. And we have an experience when we were younger, we had the best out of this nation. Unfortunately, those who are, let's say, Priyal's age, handling your children, we had the best, agreed? Training-wise, postgraduate education-wise, we had the best. But our children face so much of uncertainty. But we are taking it up in Christ, the hope that the fountain of Christ in us will well up with abundant life in Christ, enough for us, our children, and their future. Give me a wave on this. You work with the fountain of Christ, isn't it? What did Christ say? Whoever drinks the water that I will give him shall never thirst. What is thirst? Rundown, corruption, so many good things gone bad. Nobody to coach our cricket team. Serious. Very talented fellows. They play excellent strokes. Now you may ask how I know, because I have a grandson who insists that I must sort of look at these things, you know. But nobody to coach them. What a tragedy, isn't it? And so many other things. Sri Lanka is so endowed. But we are determined, the fountain of Christ in us. Shall we say together, the fountain of Christ in me? Fountain of Christ in me will be a well of water springing up to eternal life. I will not go back to the thirst. I will not go back to the put down. I will not go down back to the bad treatment, which may be very personal, very personal. At the same time, when governments do bad mistakes, we feel very badly treated, correct? We feel very badly treated. And we keep thinking we can take it up. But what about our children? Children's children. But we don't want to go that way, because we want to stick with the fountain of Christ, which is redemption. Jesus said, Luke 21:28, look up, for your redemption draws near. That's where we are looking up. Look down, apocalyptic. That's what Putin has done. He has just obeyed the book of Revelation. That's what he does not know. He's obeying the book of Revelation. Book of Revelation says the trouble starts with the king of the north. He has started the trouble. Others will follow. That's what's happening. It's very painful. It's very painful. But we have now got the pandemic that came as a sign. We have got the war beginning as a sign. So of all people, Christians must be much more prepared, much more expectant and occupied in these times. That's the last conversation we are going to look at. So Christ offers hope for the future, escape from the present drudgery. Christ addresses a need rather than an offense. Will you write that somewhere? Christ addressed her need rather than her offense. He didn't go to have fisticuffs. You are talking wrong. Why are you speaking like that? You are very offensive. He didn't go to have a boxing fight with her on that. Kept addressing the deep need in her heart, because he wants to be God-honoring, spirit-edifying, soul-saving. Don't get distracted with anything else. Then she switches from the eternal to the temporal. The woman said to him, sir, now she's respectful, you know. She's respectful. Sir, give me this water so I will not be thirsty, nor come all the way here to draw. So breakthrough is coming. She mellows down. Christ's winsome approach wins. So we must not trip from eternal to the temporal. Keep going at the person's eternal need. Dawn will come. Keep going at your spiritual need, dawn will come. It'll be couched, covered, veiled in a lot of personal pain. But go on with your spiritual need, dawn will come. He said to her, go, call your husband and come here. Now see, it's after a long conversation. He gets a word of knowledge. He had the word of knowledge at the beginning itself. But she approaches the most painful, hurtful, inner sanctum of her heart very carefully. At the time he knew, she is ready. Say with me, she is ready. I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you have correctly said, I have no husband, for you have had 5 husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. This you have said truly. A specific word of knowledge for the needed breakthrough, only possible after much bridge building. LCC, life-changing conversation, is the basis of divine intervention. He had to get her to get to her need, difficult situation. Woman said to her, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and you people say that in Jerusalem, again she got, you know, took a stay. You people say we must worship in Jerusalem, but our people say we must worship in this mountain. She may be trying to avoid the embarrassment of her personal truth with a theological diversion. So Jesus gave up the theological argument and goes deep into her heart. Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, an hour is coming when neither in this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. But an hour is coming and now is when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For such people the Father seeks to be his worshippers. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit. Woman said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming. She believes he who is called Christ, he is coming. When that one comes, He will declare all things to us. So she puts off the transformation to the future because the present is too painful. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am He. Jesus did not tell this to anybody else. Read your New Testament. This is the only time He says, I am He. One more time He said it. The born blind man, you remember born blind man? He created an eye, took some mud and created an eye, and the synagogue put him out. And he said, tell me who is the Messiah that I may worship. Jesus said, I am He. That's the only other instance. But to this lady, He reveals Himself. And she changes. So the woman left her water pots and went into the city and said to the men, come, see a man who told me all the things that I have done. This is not the Christ, is it? Many more believed because of His word. And they were saying to the woman, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves and know that this one is indeed the Savior of the world. We want to have the worship team. Shall we sing Woman at the Well and quickly get on to our last conversation? So the five objections she raised, racial and religious objection. Jesus overcame it by speaking to her felt need. Two, tradition is greater. So we also must check out whether tradition is holding us. Jesus switched to the eternal. Then she switched from eternal to temporal. Jesus switches from general to specific word of knowledge about her need. Four, she switched from personal to theological. Jesus switches from place to person, from ritual to her need for regeneration. Woman switches to the future. Jesus says, future has already come. I am the Messiah. Shall we say Amen? Shall we sing Woman at the Well? Have the men at the well forsaken? Then few more scriptures and we are done. God honoring, spirit edifying, soul saving. Shall we just rise to our feet just to honor this Jesus conversation and the Jesus moment, Jesus saying, I am He. seated for 5 minutes. You hold on. Next conversation, the context is very different. This is Paul speaking to his long-term spiritual son, Timothy. This is the authority for the life-changing conversation. I solemnly charge you. This is Paul's last talk to Timothy. Soon he'll be dead. I solemnly charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom. Sounds like a parting solemn charge. Can be done only on the basis of long trusting relationship. Ongoing conversation between spiritual senior and son in the faith, Paul and spiritual son Timothy. For though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet you do not have many fathers. For I have begotten you in Christ Jesus through the gospel. That's the underlying basis of Paul, what Paul is telling Timothy. Components of the conversation. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. It's quite a time like that for us now, isn't it? Quite a time like that. The book of Joel, in 3 chapters, gives the world's history from the point of Israel's renewal. So chapter 1 is what Israel goes through, and then Israel is renewed. Chapter 2 is about the rising of the northern army who will do monstrous things. Word exactly is monstrous thing. So the northern army has risen up and they are doing monstrous things, showing us that end is near. So let me read Joel very briefly in the context of what Paul is telling Timothy. Joel's army, or the army that Joel mentions. Joel 2. Joel 2. Verse 20, I will remove the far from you the northern army, will drive him away into a barren and desolate land, and his face towards the eastern sea and his back towards the western sea. His stench will come up and his foul odor will rise because he has done monstrous things. So God has to deal with this army. But what this army, the trouble the northern army begins. Now remember, northern in the context of Israel. So Russia is north of Israel. They can be identified by the term you find in Ezekiel 38, Gog of Magog. All the different groups that went on to make the Russian people are found in Genesis chapter 10. Under the sons and grandsons of Japheth, the son of Noah. So that's it. I said a lot of things in that. But remember that he will do monstrous things. And no NATO power will challenge him. So only his own monstrosity has to catch up with him, and God has to catch up with him. He sets off this trend. That's where we are. And Joel chapter 3 says, when that happens, this is what will happen. Joel chapter 3, verse 10. All the mighty men, let all the men of war draw near, let them come up. Beat your plowshares into swords. So what are the nations now saying? Beat your plowshares into swords. What did the UN mandate say? Beat your swords into plowshares. That's from Isaiah. But the nation's head will change and they will come to a time they tell each other, make swords out of your plowshares. Stop normal work and make war machinery. Immediately, Germany had to upgrade with 250 billion euro because they have 137 fighter jets, only 4 are flying. Only 4 are flying. They have closed up all their nuclear reactors. They have closed up all their coal generation power plants. 40% of their gas is dependent on Russia, the Nord Stream. Can you see how compromised the West is? That's the problem. But that's what nations do. We mind what Christians do. Will you say amen to that? But you need to get the context. We are in a time, Joel has described, beat your plowshares into swords, your pruning hooks into spears, let the weak say, I am strong. So all small nations will also give up feeding the people and scramble to buy arms. You understand the madness? So it's on us. Therefore, Paul's advice to Timothy, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, show how to change. Rebuke, show what to change. Exhort, come alongside in order to change. This morning, Jehan used a scripture from Ephesians 4:29. Please listen to Jehan's morning message. It's very different to what I'm doing now. It's useful to have a different perspective of life-shaping conversations. Ephesians 4:29. Very quickly, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to bearers. The Greek word for edification is oikodome. It means removing the bad parts and bringing good material. So the challenge is, we feel all what we have is good enough. Did you understand? The word for edification means a structural change in our thinking, in our spirit and in our soul and in our lifestyle. Give me a way if you understood that. Structural change in our thinking, our lifestyle, our ambitions, our preferences. For the structural change, it's a refurbishment. How many of you like to break your living room and start again? Nobody. 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 Our living room we are so comfortable with. But the Lord is saying, time has come. This is edification. Remove the decaying, add the things the Lord will supply. Only thing, He has to do it with us. So who is doing the edification or the structural refurbishment? He and me. He takes material from me, the decaying stuff, and puts into me the stuff that will grow and stand the test of time. This is what it means to reprove, rebuke, exhort, of course means paraklesis, come alongside in all this. Come alongside. Paul is telling Timothy, his spiritual son, come alongside believers and help them to get the trash out and the treasure in. Let's say together, trash out and the treasure in. There's not much more time. That's what Paul is telling Timothy, very relevant to us. This is the time, with great patience and instruction. Such aspects of conversations are involved in discipleship. Will modern day church life agree to such life-changing conversations? Or will people come to church to maintain status quo and hope it'll be all right? All the world is screaming that it is not all right. Order has changed. So Christian has to take his Christian call strongly. And what I saw was, every Christian is given a silver cord from the throne of God. It's yours. You hold on to it. All that you do is provided in the silver cord. That's why Jesus said, look up, your redemption is drawing nigh. Look down, you'll get embroiled with the things that go on. Consciously say, when trouble is, trouble troubles you, isn't it? When trouble is brewing, it is troublesome. Every bit of thing in Sri Lanka is difficult. But we refuse to get overridden by the difficulty. We say, I hold on to the silver cord, which will supply all my need according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus, not according to the wise decisions of the government. We hope they get wiser, but we still hold on to the redemptive cord of Christ, from which our children, our family, our grandchildren, anyone we can influence, this is the time to get them to know the silver cord. This is the time. Finally, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, wanting to have their ears tickle, turn away their ears from the truth. Paul is impressing on Timothy that evil times require more vigorous faith. Paul is encouraging Timothy to gear up people from listening to seduction, deception, flesh-pleasing doctrines and sermons. Life change would be truth-guided. Take care to whom you listen. Do not stop hearing medicinal truth because it's bitter. And Paul says, this is parting gesture to Timothy, I have fought the good fight of faith. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. In the future there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved His appearing. So our priorities are good fight of faith, living in the light of eternity, living accountable to the King Eternal. Our priorities are good fight of faith, living in the light of eternity, living accountable to the King Eternal. Even in our workplace, we have a silver cord of redemption.